Morning and welcome to our matin service this morning. My name's Philip Ritchie. I'm the Ministry and Mission Advisor for the Colchester area team. It's great to join you this morning, and a little bit later I'll be going down to Ardley as well. Just like to, along with welcoming you here in person, welcome those who are joining us online. We look forward to sharing in worship together and asking that God would speak to us by his Spirit this morning. Before we begin our service with our first hymn, I've got one set of bands of marriage to publish. And so I published the bands of marriage between Joseph Mark Hanlon of St. Andrew's Wheeley and Jodie Jane Louise Hall, also of St. Andrew's Wheeley, and on the electoral roll. This is for the third time of asking, and if anyone knows a reason in law why these persons may not marry, you are to declare it. So let's spend a moment just praying for Joseph and Jodie and for all those who are preparing for marriage at this time. Heavenly Father, giver of all good things and source of all love, we ask for your blessing on Joseph and Jodie, who are shortly to be married. May they live together in love and peace all the days of their lives, seeking one another's welfare, bearing one another's burdens, and sharing one another's joys, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And so would you please stand if you're able, and we'll sing our first hymn, Soldiers of Christ, Arise. Dearly beloved brethren, the scripture moveth us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, and that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with an humble, lowly, penitent and obedient heart, to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the same by his infinite goodness and mercy. And although we ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before God, Yet we ought most chiefly so to do when we assemble and meet together to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at his hands, to set forth his most worthy praise, to hear his most holy word, and to ask those things which are requisite and necessary, as well for the body as the soul. Wherefore I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with a pure heart and humble voice unto the throne of the heavenly grace, saying after me, Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And there is no health in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare thou them, O God, which confess their faults. Restore thou them that are penitent, according to thy promises, declare unto mankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, and hath given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardoneth and absolveth all them that with true repentance and unfeignedly believe his holy gospel. Wherefore let us beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which we do at this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We're going to say the responses this morning. O Lord, open thou our lips, and our mouths shall show forth thy praise. O God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be, world without end. Amen. Praise ye the Lord. The Lord's name be praised. So we remain standing to sing our psalm this morning, which is Psalm 63, verses 1 to 8. And you'll find that on page 483 of the Common Worship Book. Psalm 63.
Thank you.
readings, which Anne is going to bring to us.
First reading is taken Corinthians chapter 10 verses 1 to 13 and can be found on page 1151 of the Pew Bibles. For I do not want you to be ignorant of the fact, brothers and sisters, that our ancestors were all under the cloud and that they all passed through the sea. They were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. They all ate the same spiritual food and drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them, and that rock was Christ. Nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them. Their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. Now these things occurred as examples to keep us from setting our hearts on evil things as they did. Do not be idolaters as some of them were. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and got up to indulge in revelry. We should not commit sexual immorality as some of them did. And in one day, 23,000 of them died. We should not test Christ as some of them did and were killed by snakes. And do not grumble as some of them did and were killed by the destroying angel. These things happened to them as examples and were written down as warnings for us, on whom the culmination of the ages has come. So if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. No temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide you a way out so that you can endure it. Here ends the first lesson.
We stand if we're able to sing the Te Deum.
We are called to be.
We sit for our second reading, which Julia is going to bring to us.
The second reading is taken from Luke chapter 13, verses 1 to 9, and can be found on page 1046 of your Pew Bible. Now there were some present at that time who told Jesus about the Galileans, whose blood Pilate had mixed with their sacrifices. Jesus answered, "Do you think that these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered this way? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will all perish. Or those 18 who died when the tower in Siloam fell on them, do you think they were more guilty than all the others living in Jerusalem? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will all perish." Then he told this parable: a man who had a fig tree growing in his vineyard, and he went to look for fruit on it, but did not find any. So he said to the man who took care of the vineyard, "For 3 years now, I have been coming to look for fruit on this fig tree, and I haven't found any. Cut it down. Why should it use up the soil?" "Sir," the man replied, "leave it alone for one more year, and I'll dig round it and fertilize it. If it bears fruit next year, fine. If not, then cut it down."
We stand, if we're able, to sing the Benedictus.
Blessed be the God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people, and hath raised up a mighty salvation for us in the house of his servant David. As he spake by the mouth of his holy prophet,
So we affirm our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again. And is sitting at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. O Lord, show thy mercy upon us,
and grant us thy salvation.
O Lord, save the Queen,
and mercifully hear us when we call upon.
Endue thy ministers with righteousness,
and make thy chosen people joyful.
O Lord, save thy people,
and bless thy inheritance.
Give peace in our time, O Lord,
because there is none other that fighteth for us, but only thou, O God.
O God, make clean our hearts within us,
and take not thy Holy Spirit from us.
The collect for this, the third Sunday in Lent. We beseech thee, Almighty God, look upon the hearty desires of thy humble servants, and stretch forth the right hand of thy majesty to be our defence against all our enemies. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The second collect is the collect for peace, and as we pray this, we lift before God all that is taking place in Ukraine at this time. O God, who art the author of peace and lover of concord, in knowledge of whom standeth our eternal life, whose service is perfect freedom, defend us, thy humble servants, in all assaults of our enemies, that we, surely trusting in thy defence, may not fear the power of any adversaries, through the might of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O Lord, our Heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, who has safely brought us to the beginning of this day, defend us in the same with thy mighty power, and grant that this day we fall not into sin, neither run into any kind of danger, but that in all our doings may be ordered by thy governance to do always that is right in thy sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May I speak in the name of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Every now and again, there's a new word or a phrase which appears in public discourse, and it makes its way into the Oxford English Dictionary as a sign that it's become a word of common parlance. And one of the words that has become used more commonly in our society is the word doom scrolling. Have you ever heard the word doom scrolling? D-O-O-M scrolling. Does anyone know what it means? Some of you do. Okay, I'll tell you what it means. It's connected with social media and the internet, and it describes people who spend all their time, or a lot of their time, addicted to scrolling through the news feeds to see what disaster has happened or how a disaster has unfolded. And I have to confess, I'm someone who sometimes doom scrolls. I find myself on Twitter and I see about a story, breaking news it usually says in big letters, and I start to flick through to try and find out what's happened. I have to say, most of my doom scrolling is connected with Manchester United these days, but that's beside the point. But of course, you don't just need to do it on social media. All you need to do at the moment is to turn on your television. And it seems to be a whole series of stories of doom and disaster. The doom scrolling is done for us in the media, whether it's on television, on the radio, or in our newspapers. The tragedy of what is going on in Ukraine at the moment. Story after story coming out about what is happening to the people there. The terrible things that are being done. The people fleeing from disaster. And that story has tended to dominate the news headlines, but every now and again, another story crops up. And so we heard a few days ago about the floods in Western Australia. And people losing their lives there. Before that, there was the hurricane, which devastated the island of Tonga. We don't hear much about that now, but when the cameras got in there, we found that whole communities were wiped out. And of course, all of us have been caught up in the disaster of the pandemic of the last couple of years. And many of us are still suffering from that. And when these things happen, they cause us to ask questions. And the main question is, why has this happened? Why has this been allowed to happen? In fact, it's normally honed in a bit tighter than that. Why has God allowed this to happen? And it's not just everyday folk who ask that. Christians ask that question as well. God, why has this been allowed to happen? When we hear stories of people who have narrowly escaped from disaster, the temptation is to say, God saved them. But then the question comes, well, why did God save them and not that person over there? What's going on here? And this is not a new thing. These are questions that have been asked down through history. And so we see in the Old Testament, for example, the writers of the Old Testament, the psalmists, the prophets, and others, wrestling with this question, why does God allow suffering? Why does God allow disaster? Why does God allow these things to happen? And I guess the best known story of that from the Old Testament is in the book of Job, where a righteous man suffers all sorts of disasters and he cries out and he wants to know what's happening. And of course, he's got some so-called friends who come along and are only too keen to point him out all the things that they think are wrong with his life that have led to disaster. Why has God allowed this to happen? In our reading from Luke chapter 13, and if you have a Bible, you might like to turn to it, Luke chapter 13, verses 1 and following, we hear about two disasters. The first disaster is caused by Pilate, the governor of Judea at that time. And we hear about the murder of some Galileans. And then the second disaster is the disaster of a tower, the Tower of Siloam, falling upon a group of people there and killing them. Why have these things happened? Why have these things happened? This is a question that was asked of Jesus again and again, isn't it? People would point to a blind man and say, Jesus, who sinned, this man or his parents, that this should happen to him? And of course, this was the thing, wasn't it? That people tended to associate disaster falling upon people. They certainly did it with Job. They did it with people in Jesus' day. That disaster was somehow a divine punishment. That these people were being punished for something that they had done wrong or something that their family had done wrong. Who has sinned that this has happened? Well, one of the explanations of why disasters happen is because of sin. But not necessarily because of the sin of the person upon whom the disaster has fallen. As I mentioned, a group of Galileans had gone up to Jerusalem to worship, and they are murdered by Pilate. We think of Pilate as being a kind of rather wimpish figure who's swayed by the crowds. Well, let me assure you that you didn't become the governor of Judea, appointed by Caesar in one of the most troublesome parts of the empire, unless you were the sort of person who could impose Rome's rule. You were there as Caesar's fist to stamp on any rebellion. What seems to have happened is a group of Galilean worshippers have gone to the temple. Caesar, through Pilate, has determined that they may be rabble-rousers, they may be trying to stir up rebellion. We don't know the reason, but that may have been the reason. And Pilate has them killed. And the horror is that their blood mingles with the blood of the sacrifices in the temple, despoiling both them and the sacrifices that were being offered. It's one of those things that it's very difficult for us to understand just how horrific that would have been to the faithful people of Jesus' day. And Pilate did this. He did a number of other things as well, just to remind people that Rome was in charge. It was the sin of Pilate and the evil of the Roman Empire that caused the suffering of those people. And so we can say, yes, disaster may be the result of sin, but not necessarily the sin of the person who suffers the disaster. It could very easily be the result of the sin of others. And when we look at the situation in Ukraine at the moment, when we see women and babies in bomb shelters being attacked, when we see soldiers shooting people walking down the road with their arms up, others seeking to flee and being attacked by tanks, then yes, we can say this is the result of sin. The sin of Putin and those who have been charged with doing his will at the moment. The people who are suffering are the innocent. And that's the thing about sin, isn't it? That's the horror of sin. It has such a terrible impact on all those around about, not necessarily on the person committing the sin. And we can think of other situations that we're aware of where, because of someone's evil acts, others have suffered, either individually or corporately. So we must recognize that disaster and suffering may indeed be as the result of sin. But not always. It may simply be down to people's frailty or stupidity. It may be down to human weakness. The tower that fell in Siloam, which was in a part of Jerusalem, we're not told why it fell down, but it could easily have fallen down because it wasn't built properly. I mean, that's not difficult to imagine, is it? Because we've got those stories in our own time of the collapse of buildings where the builder decided to cut corners, make a bit more of a profit by not using the right concrete, not building in the right way, not following the right safety instructions. And as a result of it, disaster has fallen upon others. The Grenfell Tower inquiry is still ongoing, but what we've heard already tells us that actually that building was not built as it should have been built. And as a result of that, many, many people lost their lives or were injured. Many others were bereaved. And that tower in that community stands as a reminder that things are not right. Now, whether it was greed or stupidity or people just not getting it right, we don't know yet. We wait for the inquiry to come out. But we can see in situation after situation that sometimes people suffer disaster because of human frailty and the stupidity of others. I remember a few years ago, an earthquake taking place in San Francisco. Perhaps you can remember it. It was back at the end of the 1980s. And there was a very famous film clip where a freeway actually collapsed during the earthquake. And it landed on the cars below, on the road below, and also the cars fell off. And many people were killed on that day. And I remember a woman being interviewed afterwards on the television, and she said, "I just didn't think that this could happen here. I didn't think it was going to happen." And I found myself sort of open-mouthed watching her say that, because I thought, hang on a minute. History and science tells us that one place that is almost certain to be hit by an earthquake is San Francisco. It's actually built on a geological fault line where you have earthquakes. There have been earthquakes there before. But it's a really nice place to live. And so people build their houses there. They try and protect them from earthquakes, but nevertheless, they decide to take the risk. I mean, I felt very sorry for this woman, but at the same time, I wanted to say, but you knew that that was a place where earthquakes happen. Sometimes people take risks and then things go wrong. Other disasters don't happen because of sin or because of human frailty, weakness, but because of the nature of our world. And we see that, don't we, with the tsunamis and the hurricanes and the other devastation around about us. I mean, if I'm honest, it feels at the moment as if we're getting more than our fair share of these. You know, we don't just get through one storm and then the next one's coming. But I mean, perhaps it's a reminder to us of other parts of the world where people are facing this all the time, particularly those living in those vulnerable Pacific islands, for example. No matter how careful we are, nevertheless, we can still be exposed to disaster. And so we find ourselves saying, why does this happen? Why does this happen? Is it God's judgment on us? Is this in some way God taking his punishment out on us for what we have done wrong? Well, if I'm honest, well, first of all, that's not the way that God acts. But if I'm honest, if it was the way that God acts, I think I'd have spent most of my life dodging thunderbolts, because I know all the things that I've done wrong in my life. And let's be honest, that's true for most of us, isn't it? I mean, if that's the way God worked, then we'd all be dodging lightning bolts and thunderbolts all the time. That's not how God works. And Jesus in his ministry made it clear that that's not how God works. It's not because of one person's sinfulness that they necessarily suffer. We don't believe in karma. I mean, that's what karma teaches, that what goes around comes around. You know, you get what you deserve. You've done something wrong, something bad's going to happen to you. That's not the way it works. So what does Jesus say when he's confronted with this challenge? Why were these Galileans murdered? Why were those people in Siloam crushed by the town? Well, the first thing Jesus makes clear is that it wasn't because of their sin that these things happened. That's the first point that Jesus makes. It's not because of these people's sin. As I say, many people believed during Jesus' time that that was the reason. If something was wrong with someone, it was because they'd done something bad or evil. And Jesus says, no, it's not true. That's not the way that God works. God doesn't punish individuals by sending disaster in that way. I think it's important for us to hold on to that, because even now, people are tempted to think like that, aren't they? Even some Christians. I'm suffering because I've done something wrong. If you're tempted to feel that, let me say to you, don't feel like that. That's not the way our God works. That's not the way that our God works. His longing is for everyone to know his love and grace and peace and healing and restoration. But then Jesus goes on to say something else. And this is the hard part of our reading this morning. Why did these people suffer? Had they done something wrong? No, says Jesus, but unless you repent, you will perish just as they did. Hang on a minute, I thought you said God doesn't cause suffering as a sign of divine judgment. Jesus isn't saying that here. What he's saying is that when we see something happening like these disasters, whether they're caused by the evil of others or whether they're a natural catastrophe, they confront us with our own mortality. That's the thing about a disaster, isn't it? It comes out of the blue. It's something that is unexpected. What Jesus says is when we see what has happened in these situations, it should cause us to stop and think, what if this had happened to me? What if I'd been in that temple when Pilate murdered the Galileans? What if I'd been in that building when the tower collapsed. Would I be in a right relationship with God? Would I be ready to meet God face to face? And so Jesus says, this is an opportunity for us, or a challenge for us, not an opportunity, a challenge for us to stop and reflect on our own mortality. Am I ready? Am I prepared for what may be just around the corner? And Jesus went on to say, well, look, there's only one way to be ready. And he uses that word, repent. Repent. Turn around. Stop walking away from God. Turn towards God. Open your life to receive the kingdom of God that I have caught to bring amongst you, to announce amongst you. Turn, repent, and receive the forgiveness, the love, and the grace, the mercy of God. So that you might be reconciled with him and with your brothers and sisters. So that you might know that shalom, that peace that comes from knowing that you are in a right relationship with God. And during this Lent period, we're challenged as followers of Jesus to take time out to think, am I in that right relationship with God? If disaster was to strike me today, would I be ready? And we have that wonderful assurance, don't we, that when we do turn to God, when we do receive his love, his forgiveness, his grace, his mercy through the Lord Jesus Christ and all that he has done for us, then we can have confidence that whatever comes, whatever assaults us, whatever confronts us in this life, our future is secure in God. There's that wonderful promise, isn't there, that nothing in all creation can separate us from the love of God in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so when we see those who face disaster today, when we see what's happening in the Ukraine, when we see those natural disasters taking place in different parts of our world, we pray for those people and for those communities. We cry out to God for justice and for release. We also step back as we're reminded of our own mortality and reflect on our own relationship with God. If this was to happen to me today, would I be ready? Going to stand to sing our next hymn, which is number 621, Dear Lord and Father of Mankind, Forgive Our Foolish Ways.
Thank you.
Now, Lynn is going to come and lead us in our intercessions.
The season of Lent, a time that can feel a bit like being in a wilderness, and as we have heard from our readings, a time of reflection about our own selfish desires and how we should be more inclined to turn from evil and towards God, who has promised he will help us withstand temptations. Guide us, Lord, through these days, that it may be a time for recollection in truthfulness and reality, and lead us to a deeper sense of responsibility and gratitude for all that we have. Save us from slack indulgence and selfish planning, and help us always to be ready to reach out sacrificially to others in love and helpfulness whenever we can. Deliver us from grudges and resentment, and give us courage and perseverance when it gets tough. Lord, you have enriched us by the Christian experiences of many men and women before us. Let us profit from their discoveries, their mistakes, and their love, and take time to consider our own values and choices, mindful that all our inmost motivations are known to you. Let us develop a new responsiveness to you, so that this is no casual preparation of a festival, but a real experience of renewal and loving purpose. Heavenly Father, we come before you in a privileged position of interceding for our world and for each other. We cry out to you on behalf of our brothers and sisters who are suffering in any way at present. We are only too well aware of the sadness, wickedness, and atrocities of war and injustice in so many places at this time. We have particularly in mind the people of Ukraine and Russia. But we also remember the many other places where disaster, turmoil, hatred, and persecution exist. And as Desmond Tutu has said, your dream, O God, is that we all realize we are one family and that we are made for goodness and compassion. So, Lord, we long for this justice and compassion. But teach each of us that we need to play our part, however small, in bringing this about. And heed what we are told in Scripture, which is not just to love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth. We ask you earnestly to turn and soften the hearts of rulers and authorities who would hurt and destroy. We pray for our government and all the leaders and peacemakers everywhere, asking that they would seek your wisdom in all their decision making. We pray too for all engaged in helping and serving those in great need. We thank you for them and we ask for your protection on them. We pray finally for any in need or illness at this time, remembering Mick Burley and Carol Mitson, and we pray quietly for any others on our minds and hearts. We also remember those no longer with us, naming Ian Sutherland and Rosemary Hartley from our church membership, and again, anyone else we know of personally. We pray for their families and all families everywhere in the world who are grieving the loss of a loved one. You tell us something beautiful, something scarcely believable, that even in the blast of an unkind world, we are loved extravagantly. When life's claims press heavily, enable us to lean on you, O God, with a real dependence, and so triumph in Christ, as we keep in mind the joy of Easter and all that it truly means. Amen.
Would you please stand? So as we gather all our prayers and thoughts, our reflections, all that we have sung and said this morning together, let us pray for one another and for all those that we love as we say together the words of the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. And so we sing our final hymn, number 652. Guide me, O thou great Redeemer. I ought to say, after what happened to the Welsh rugby team yesterday, perhaps the song's a bit unfortunate. But, but let's remember that God is faithful and dependable whatever happens, as we sing, Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer.